Continuing with the topic of sequential elements, let's take a look at some increasingly complex ways of implementing a basic latch structure, right? The idea of a dynamic latch, a dynamic or static latch. So we are going to concentrate first on how we implement latches, and then after that, once we have seen many different varieties of implementing latches, we will look at how we can implement flip-flops by using or other registers by using the same kind of structure. Okay. So the first and most basic kind of latch is just this. Okay. How does it work? Essentially what we are saying is we'll give a clock signal over here. The D input, we'll consider this as the Q output. Okay. Now implicitly what we are saying is there is some capacitance over here, which means that any time that the clock signal becomes equal to 1, Q gets the value that was there on D. Okay. If D was 1, then Q becomes 1. If D was 0, then Q becomes 0. That's a regular path. And then clock is equal to 0, Q will hold the last value on the capacitor. Right? So even this circuit can be thought of as a simple form of a latch. Now obviously there are some drawbacks associated with this. What can you think of? What are the problems that you can think of with this circuit? Using it as a latch. This is just a repetition of things that we have been doing previously, but I just want to see if people are also following along in class. Huh? Leakage. Yes, so leakage is definitely one of the problems that we have over there, right? What does leakage do? Essentially what it's saying is this charge, we are assuming that the charge is being stored on the capacitor, and that is what is acting as the memory element as far as the sequential circuit is concerned. Right? Which means that it is susceptible to leakage current. There will be some leakage through the NMOS transistor or through, possibly even through whatever else it is connected to. Right? Because even though the gate leakage as such, we have not really considered, we have not discussed that explicitly, but there is leakage current even through the gate of a transistor. Right? That is something that we have not explicitly discussed so far, but even that exists, especially in smaller technologies. So in any case, there can be leakage currents that affect the charge stored at chip. Apart from that, what else is there? What is the other basic problem as far as pass transistors are concerned? There is one. Right? What that means is, if D was 0, then that's fine. Q will become equal to 0. It will take the value properly. Then when phi becomes equal to 0, okay, it will hold that value. It will hold the value of 0 and act as a latch. But when D is equal to VDD, Q can at most rise up to VDD minus VDD. Right? Not all the way up to VDD. So that becomes a problem. It basically means that the charge is stored over there only corresponds to a voltage of VDD minus VDD. And that's not a strong signal, not as strong a signal as you would like to. Okay? So even though this circuit can behave like a basic latch, it has a number of problems associated with it. Now at least one of those problems can be fixed. How? Yeah, so instead of a pass transistor, what do we usually do? Fix the problem of weak one by using a transmission gate instead of a pass transistor, right? So this is the next possible structure that we have. Okay. Once again, this also acts as a latch. Same principle of behavior. This is the D input, Q output, phi n, phi bar. One problem of course is you need phi and phi bar both. So even though the latch itself requires only two transistors, you need another two transistors in order to generate the phi bar, the clock complex. Okay. So this solves the problem of the weak one from coming through. It still has the problem of leakage and coupling. Okay. And primarily, more than anything else, what that leakage and coupling is doing is, it means that at the output node, if there is any noise, right? Why specifically at the output node? Because the output is in turn connected to other signals, right? Other signals are not connected as the input, but this in turn is connected to the gate of certain other gate to the gate input of other transistors corresponding to other gates. Okay. Any cross capacitance which is present between that point and any other point in the circuit will result in output noise feeding in over here and corrupting the value which is being stored at the lab. Okay. So now there's one thing that can be done in order to eliminate the effect of this output noise, or at least reduce the effect. And this approach is to say, instead of just leaving the transmission gate as such, we'll also put an inverter over here. Okay? This looks like a very minor improvement or change to the circuit. What it achieves is, now effectively this inverter is acting as an isolation state. It isolates the input from the output. Right? It acts sort of like a buffer. Okay? Now, the reason why this becomes important is because previously it was directly the diffusion region, right? The source terminal of the pass transistor, which was driving the next state. Okay? And in turn, as far as the input side is also concerned, we are directly driving the drain terminal of a pass transistor. Right? The problem with that approach is that the drain terminal or source terminal, they are not insulating terminals, unlike the gate. Okay? Which means that you are not effectively able to isolate the input from the output. By adding this extra inverter over here, two things happen. One is that the capacitance at this point is now a known capacitance. You don't have to rely on what it is connected to. You don't have to worry about what is the load capacitance that is present and whether that is big enough to store the charge that you require. Right? You have put an inverter. That inverter's input capacitance is the load capacitance as far as the transmission gate is concerned. That is what is responsible for storing the charge. Okay? At the same time, you also have that any output noise at this output terminal will not feed back into the input because it is separated from the transmission gate itself by that inverter. Okay? So this, even though a minor change to the circuit, already helps in terms of sort of isolating the output from the input. Okay? another variant of this is to say, instead of protecting the output, we protect the input cell. Okay. Over here, we say that the input also consists of the drain diffusion terminal, which means that it's not an insulating input. So to protect that, we'll put a buffer stage over there and protect it from any possible noise which happens at the input. Okay. In the ideal case, we need to have inverters on both sides. Right? And in fact, when we construct a latch out of this, that is typically what, not a latch, a resistor out of this, that is typically what happens. Okay? But we'll get to that later. Now, one common problem with all of these structures that we have looked at so far is that they are dynamic, right? Meaning that they all rely on charge storage at some point, at some capacitance inside the circuit, right? Which means that they are all susceptible to the problems of leakage, and with time, eventually, the charge on the capacitance will leak away. So there is some kind of restriction on the minimum frequency at which these things need to switch, so that they will retain their value. Okay? So to avoid that, the next set of improvements that we can look at is essentially to make the storage, the memory element, static. So how do we make this memory element static? Add feedback. Okay? And typically what is done over there is, we'll consider this feedback inverter. We use this symbol for it, right? What we mean by this is that this is a so-called tri-state inverter. Okay. The structure is this. Just consider this inverter structure. What we are saying over here is, how does this behave? When clock is equal to 0, that is pi is equal to 0 and pi bar is equal to 1, both of these intermediate transistors, the ones in the middle of the circuit, are on. They both are conducting. Okay? And what happens as a result of that is, the output will be equal to the input. Or rather, will be equal to complement of the input. Right? That is to say, when pi is equal to 0, pi bar is equal to 1, this just behaves like a regular inverter. But when pi is equal to 1 and pi bar is equal to 0, what effectively happens is both of these transistors turn off and the output gets disconnected from the input. Disconnected as in electrically disconnected. There is no conducting path connecting the output to anything related to the input. This kind of a structure is called a tri-state inverter, and the reasons if you think about it are obvious. First of all, it behaves as an inverter as long as the clock is low, right? And once the clock becomes high, that is to say clock bar becomes 0, the inward structure will basically separate the, just disconnect the output from the input. Okay? They'll tri-state it, they'll say basically put it into a high impedance state. Okay? Now if you look a bit more closely at this circuit, what you'll see is, if I connect these two points, right, the circuit then becomes this, right, because now this point and this point are shorted together. The output is taken from the other junction between the two, between the one PMOS and NMOS. Okay? So in other words, the structure looks very much like an regular inverter followed by a transmission gate, with the one difference that you don't have an extra contact, right? So this common terminal over here, in this case, needs to be explicitly contacted, meaning that you need, by doing the layout, you need to provide space for actually putting a metal contact over there. Whereas in the case of the tri-state inverter, you don't have that contact, so it is marginally smaller in terms of the layout. Okay? So anyway, what we do is we use this tri-state inverter as a feedback element in this kind of a latch. And by doing so, effectively make this static. Right? This is no longer a dynamic circuit. You can keep it for as long as you want and it will retain the last value that was seen over there. Okay? Now, a further improvement over this, we are getting close to sort of what is one of the most robust latch structures. We still have the problem that on the input side, this one is exposed. I mean, you just have a drain diffusion region which is exposed to the connection from the previous stage. So, put another inverter over there and protect the input as well. And to sort of take this to its logical conclusion, one thing we can say is, I don't want ideally to be directly taking the output from here, right? Because the same problem happens. If I try taking the output from here, and if there is any capacitive coupling of noise at this output, what does it do? It directly affects this, right? Which in turn will affect the internal state of the system. Okay? So in order to separate that also out, what we do is, take the output using a separate inverter from here. Okay? Now this structure is is one of the most robust large structures that you can design. Okay. It is protected from the on the input side by having an inverter. It's protected on the output side by having another inverter. The feedback, the charge storage itself, instead of being dynamic, is stored using a static feedback loop. That static feedback loop in turn can be explicitly broken by using the tri-state inverter, right, whenever you want to write new data into the LAN. Okay. So there are no ratios to worry about those here. All the functionality is taken care of just by the connectivity itself. The tri-state inverter takes care of breaking the loop. You don't need to worry about the relative sizes of any other transistors over here for correct functionality. Okay. The input and output are both buffered, so they are protected from noise. Yeah. No. The output is taken from here. For the upper diagram, I think. Yeah. Okay. No. We are not talking about the frequency of the noise over here. Right? Any noise, whether it is of high frequency or low frequency, anything that disturbs the voltage at that point can in turn feed back through this. Okay. No, it is feeding back directly through the inverter itself. Somehow the output node has got disturbed. How does the output node get disturbed? Because there is some capacitance connecting it with any other part of the circuit. So any change in some other part of the circuit can cause a change in the voltage at the output node. For a regular inverter, any such changes in the voltage at the output node are completely suppressed because of the fact that the inverter itself takes care of driving that output node to either VDD or to ground. Right? But for a dynamic circuit, that is not the case. There is nothing driving it to VDD or to ground in the dynamic case. Over here also you have an additional problem, that is this inverter is driving the output, but on the other hand the other inverter, the output node acts as the input to that inverter, which means that any noise of the output is going to go through that inverter and may get amplified depending on how big the noise is and depending on what the noise margin of that second inverter is. Right? For the most part, of course, if it is a small amount of noise, it should just get suppressed by that inverter as well. But it's possible that it can cause a significant change as well. If it does, then it will definitely affect the internal state. It will cause a change in the internal state of the system. Okay? So this structure over here is a overall sort of summation of all the ideas that we have got so far in terms of implementing a LAN. Okay, and is one of the most robust LAN structure. Typically this is what is used in basic standard cells for implementing LAN. Okay. Now, depending on the type of behavior that you have, one of the things that could be done is you could possibly get rid of this input inverter, provided that you have control over the kind of scenario in which you are actually going to be using the resistor. Right? So, this inverter in this latch without the input inverter, for example, was used by Intel for some of their processor core. Right? Now, that's because they have full control over the entire design of the system. They don't have to worry about who is going to connect what to the input. They know exactly both parts of the connection, right? Both what is being stored in the latch as well as what is it that is driving the latch. So as long as you can ensure that you don't have any noise coming through the light in that kind of scenario, you can directly connect up the inverter to the output. And without using the input stage inverter. Okay? Now the last sort of modification to this structure is one simplification which says instead of using a tri-stage inverter as the feedback, use a weak inverter. Okay? So what is a weak inverter? Small WP and WM. Right? So how does this work? In this case, during the time that you are trying to write data into this point over here, call it node X, right? Previously what would happen is when D is trying to drive node X, the output Q will be disconnected from X by the tri-stage. Okay? Now there is no more disconnecting. Both D and Q are driving X at the same time. So feedback inverter, that weak inverter that I've drawn over there, it must be weaker than the input state. Right? Provided that it's weaker than the input stage inverter, what will happen is that node X, if necessary, can be driven to either VDD or to ground or to a high enough voltage so that the inverter fair, the loop, will switch. Okay? The voltage at node X will be driven by a combination of D and Q. So let's say that D is trying to drive it to VDD and Q is trying to drive it to zero. Right? Because the Q inverter, the feedback inverter is weak, whereas compared to that at least, the D inverter, the input stage inverter is strong. So the voltage will be closer to VDD than to ground, closer to the voltage which D is trying to drive. Okay? When that happens, the forward inverter from X to Q, that one will flip over. And the moment it flips over, the feedback will then take care of retaining the value. So that Q is also now at 1, D is also at 1. Both of them are trying to drive the X value to 0. Okay? So that can be taken care of by having a sufficiently weak inverter over there. The main advantage is you have saved two transistors in the tri-stage in the feedback, and also the feedback inverter itself is going to be a small inverter. So even area wise it does not take up too much space. The problem with it is you now need to make sure that the sizes are such that they behave the way that you expect this system to work. Okay? Alright, so all of this was different kinds of latches. Right? In all the cases, when the clock is 1, you are trying to, the latch is transparent, meaning that whatever change you make at the input will come through to the output. So now the question becomes, how do I get an edge trigger register out of this kind of structure? Right? So in general, for converting latches into registers, there is one standard procedure which can take any given latch and convert it into a register. Okay? That configuration looks something like this. Okay. So each of the structures that I've drawn over there is a level sensitive line. Now let's look at how this behaves initially when clock is equal to 1. Okay. So when clock is equal to 1, L1 is transparent. This implies that X takes the value from Q. But L2, yeah, from D, sorry. Thanks for pointing that out. L2 on the other hand is opaque. What do you mean by opaque? It does not let anything through. Okay? Q holds the last value. Okay. Now what happens when clock becomes equal to 0? When clock becomes 0, L1 becomes opaque. So X, which was continuously, X might have been changing continuously all this while, but now it will freeze at whatever was the last value seen by D, seen at D. Right? L2 becomes transparent. So Q takes the value that is there at X. Okay? L2 is transparent, so any change in X at this point will show up directly at Q. But the point is, X is no longer changing. Right? X has now gone into a freeze mode. There is only one possible time when Q can change. At the exact instant when L1 is becoming opaque and L2 is becoming transparent. Right? Then whatever was the value at X, if it was different from the value currently stored at Q, then that value of X will come through to Q and the value of Q will change. Right? But at any other time instant, Q will remain unchanged. Initially, Q itself was in hold mode. The second latch was in hold mode. Then after that, the second latch became transparent, but the first latch went into hold mode. Okay. What is this kind of a configuration called? This is a master slave register. Okay. Is this positive X figure or negative X figure? In this case, look at when the transition happens, right? When clock is equal to 1, that is when X can be affected by the input. When clock becomes 0, Q can change. Right? So when clock goes from 1 to 0, that is when Q can change. When clock goes from 0 to 1, Q will not be allowed to change, because at that point, the second stage is becoming opaque. Okay? So this particular register, this configuration is a negative X trigger register. Okay? How do I make a positive X trigger register? Invert the nature of the clock, right? So I either I invert the clock and give it to the first one and then invert it twice and give it to the second one. Or else, I could also possibly use the negative latch at the first stage and the positive latch at the second stage. What do I mean by negative latch? Something that is transparent when the clock is low rather than when the clock is high. Okay? So this kind of a master slave register is the most common way of creating an edge triggered register and is used extensively in pretty much all kinds of designs. Okay? Now, notice that I just drew boxes for the two latches. So any one of the latch configurations that we had until now could be used in order to construct this kind of a structure. Right? So, taking it through to its sort of, you know, the complete picture over there, one structure that could be used for the master slave register is something like this. So what has happened, effectively what we have done is, we have used the multiplexer based latch structure, which is also the same as the robust latch structure that I discussed a short while earlier, right? Instead of using the tri-state inverter and the feedback, I am using an explicit transmission gate. That's the only difference, right? So this structure effectively is saying that with all of these inverters, 6 inverters and 4 transmission gates, what we have constructed is a complete edge triggered flip flop, edge triggered register. Okay. Now on this structure, it is also possible to do some amount of analysis of what the setup time, hold time, TCQ and so on of this structure should be like. Okay. These are not very accurate. The only real way of finding the setup time and hold time and so on are through simulations. But at least what we can do is look at the structure slightly and try and understand where the main contributions to setup and hold come from. Okay? So let's sort of look at what the input looks like during a transition. Right? So when does this transition actually occur? What we are saying is, the way that the master slave structure works, initially the left hand side latch must be transparent, and after it becomes opaque, that is to say at the rising edge of the clock, right, that is when whatever data is present inside the system will get stored. Okay, so in other words, we are interested in the time instant at which this first stage goes from being transparent to being opaque. Okay? Now, for data to get properly written into this first feedback loop, right, what we need to make sure of is that the data on both sides of this transmission gate are equal. Okay? How is that happening? The data is coming through this first inverter I1, going through the transmission gate, through this inverter I3, and coming to I2, then going through T2. Right? Once it has gone through I3, I2 and T2, it has done one full loop around that feedback loop, and we can be fairly sure that it's going to hold the value proper. Okay? Now, by the time it has gone through I3 and I2 itself, what it means is that the value at both sides of the transmission gate are equal. So, the transmission gate, even if it goes into hold mode, it's fine because no further changes are going to happen in the loop. Okay? So, what that effectively means is, the data has to pass through I1, then T1, then I3 and I2. Before the edge of the clock. Okay? So effectively what that says is, before the clock edge arrives, any data, the last value, the last change in the data must be at least so much time before the clock edge. In other words, that is the setup time associated with it. Okay? Now, this setup time, after that effectively what happens is that we also, so we have had a change in the clock, which means that the nature of that first pair of transmission gates has changed from conducting to opaque. Right? The second transmission gate, that is to say the second state, has to become transparent. Okay, it is becoming transparent at the same time. So effectively I need to go through I4, then T3, and then I6 for output. Right? So the data has already gone through I1 or T1 etc. before the switching of the gate. Right? That is already guaranteed by the setup time. Now it has to pass through I4, T3 and I6 in order to reach the output. Okay? This becomes the T clock to Q. That is, after the clock has changed, how long does it take for the output to change? Okay? Now the hold time is a different story. What happens in the case of hold time for a master-slave register in general is that what we are saying is, because of the very structure of the master-slave, right, there is no requirement for the data. The first stage is becoming opaque and at the same time the second stage is becoming transparent. What is it that the whole time is telling us? Once the clock changes, for some time after that the data must still not change. Okay? In other words, the whole time is putting a constraint saying that the clock has changed. Clock has gone from 0 to 1. Even after that, for some amount of time the data input must not change, otherwise it can corrupt the output. Okay? Whereas over here, for a master slave structure, by the very nature of the way it's constructed, you don't really have any such constraint at all. Okay? So in general, for master-slave configuration, the hold time can be considered to be zero. Okay? Now this is not a blanket statement, this depends of course on the relative timing of the clock signal to both the transmission gates. But provided that you design it carefully, you can make the hold time to be zero for a master slave structure. Okay? So you can make it such that after the clock changes, you don't need to worry about any further changes in the data. The data can immediately start changing and that will not come through to the output. Okay? So this essentially is a sort of just very high level overview of how you can estimate the setup time and hold time for this particular flip-flop structure. Right? But in general, it's much harder than this. It's not really possible to estimate the setup time and hold time, unlike the combinational path delay, where you can directly sort of figure out, okay, if this input changes, what is the amount of time it's going to take for the output to change. That you can figure out just by seeing what is the path taken by the current for changing the output. Okay? In the case of setup time, hold time and CPQ, it is usually much harder to estimate that. So the only way to really do this is through simulation. Okay? And what we'll be doing is, that will be one of the major projects as far as the rest of the course is concerned. Take up this flip-flop structure, implement the entire thing using magic for layout, extract the spice, simulate this and find out what is the propagation delay, that is the TCQ, the setup time as well as the hold time. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for today's class. Thank you.